Local heroes go their own way. Local heroes want to change their world. Local heroes need global insights.
We are there for you with more news and information, comprehensive background, and relevant analysis.
All the news, all the time, up to the minute. Plus, all the latest trends in business, culture, and sports. DW, Global Insights, broadcast from Germany. With continuous coverage of key stories from Europe and the world, mixed with a wide range of programs.
DW has been the trusted source of news and information for more than 60 years.
And DW also plays a prominent role in the digital age, with free, uncensored information, with a forward-looking multimedia strategy. Be well informed at any time on the move with the new DW News app. Live, interactive, personalized, and always in dialogue with users. The diverse palette of DW services, making an important contribution to the strengthening of international relations in a digital world.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your host, Terry Martin.
Thank you very much. Hello and welcome. My name is Terry Martin. Welcome to the Deutsche Welle's Global Media Forum 2015, focusing this year, and this has been around now for several years, but focusing this year on media and foreign policy in the digital age. My name is Terry Martin. I'm an anchor with DW News. You saw some of my colleagues up there just now. Deutsche Welle DW News was launched here just yesterday with some ceremonial fanfare, including the pressing of a big red button. It's a very exciting time for us. It is my honor to serve as your master of ceremonies for the rest of this Global Media Forum, both today and tomorrow. Now, I want, first of all, to welcome everyone who is just joining us today. I know many of you have come from very far away. We do have more than 2,000 participants here from about 130 countries. Many of you, of course, were here already yesterday. I want to thank everyone whose sunny disposition is helping to dispel the gloom of the rain clouds that have descended on this media forum, but I'm told the weather is about to improve. Tomorrow is certainly going to be a nicer day. During our dinner cruise on the Rhine last night, I know some of you might have been disappointed not to see the all boys group sing and dance for us, as was promised to us by the moderator of our all male panel at the end of our final session here yesterday. But I did notice a lot of people still on the dance floor last night. There was an excellent mood. There is a palpably positive atmosphere to this event, and one can certainly feel it today. Now, we did get off to an exciting start yesterday at the Global Media Forum. We heard from some very interesting keynotes, had some very thought-provoking keynotes. We had two stimulating plenary sessions, and of course, we had 11 insightful workshops, and I dipped into some of those workshops, and they were completely full. In some cases, you couldn't even get into the rooms. They were very, very well attended. I'm going to spare you an attempt to summarize proceedings yesterday. That would take too long, and I'm sure I would miss too many things, but I do just want to mention a couple of points, practical points for today moving forward. This first session this morning, as you can see up there, will be simultaneously translated into French, and that's on channel 2 if you'd like to follow that. Again, I'm going to make my remarks very brief because we want to get on promptly with what promises to be a very riveting discussion. The title of our opening plenary today is Foreign Policy in 140 Characters, How Technology is Redefining Policy. Technology, social media being an important topic at this forum today. We, of course, are Twittering here at the Global Media Forum. We are at the hashtag DW underscore GMF. And Jakob and his team here tell me that yesterday we were trending on Twitter as number one in Germany for part of the day, and we were within the top 10 in parts of southern Africa. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce a colleague of mine, also a good friend of mine, who will be moderating this first opening session today with seven esteemed panelists. Ladies and gentlemen, DW's chief political correspondent, Melinda Crane.
Thank you very, very much, Terry. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome from me as well to this plenary panel discussion. E-diplomacy, twee-diplomacy, no matter what you call it, it is a dramatically disruptive approach to the ancient art of statecraft. The use of digital technology to transmit not only text, but also images is testing power and transforming international relations. It opens up new opportunities for governments and international organizations to transmit their messages, but it also poses serious challenges for the traditional practitioners of old-school diplomacy. What used to be seen as the province of the elite and discreet, of wily diplomats trained to interact behind closed doors, is now wide open to new players with very different goals and very different tools. Anonymous, WikiLeaks, Edward Snowden, the Syrian Electronic Army, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, those are just a few of the non-state actors which have proven adept at using digital communication technologies to disrupt the institutions that once held monopolies on power. In the next hour and a half, we want to explore the implications of e-diplomacy, taking a look at both the opportunities and the challenges. We've got a very impressive panel. It does now number 5, not 7. Unfortunately, we had to see a few of our guests cancel at the last moment. They both had very, very important appointments elsewhere. But we have a very wonderful remaining 5-person panel with wide experience analyzing and practicing 21st century statecraft. I will now introduce them one by one, and I'll ask you just to come up as I introduce you and take your places, dear guests, here from left to right. So it's my pleasure to start out by introducing Nik Gowing. He was one of the main presenters at BBC World. I know most of you have certainly heard him and seen him from 1996 until last year. He is still working with the Beeb, and he's also serving as visiting professor for public policy at King's College in London. He is also on the council of the Royal Limited Service Institute, and his very extensive international experience includes stints as ITN bureau chief in Rome and Warsaw, and as diplomatic editor for Channel 4. Nik Gowing, great that you can join us. Welcome. And it's my great pleasure to welcome Dunja Mijatovic. She works with the OSCE as representative on the freedom of media. She's an expert on human rights and media policy. She founded the Communications Regulatory Agency in Bosnia and Herzegovina, and she served as chair of the Council of Europe's group of specialists on freedom of expression in times of crisis. She was recently awarded the Medaille Charlemagne European Media Prize. A warm welcome. Please take a place next to Nick. And we're very pleased that Professor Dr. Jan Melissen could join us. He is Senior Research Fellow at the Clingendael Institute of International Relations in the Netherlands. He also serves as Professor of Diplomacy at the University of Antwerp. He's an expert on public diplomacy and digitalization, has taught, lectured, and advised governments in North America, Asia, and Europe. And he is founding co-editor of the Hague Journal of Diplomacy. A warm welcome to you, Jan Melissen. If you'll take that one, please. And I'm very, very pleased to welcome Dr. Taylor Owen. He is Assistant Professor of Digital Media and Global Affairs at the University of British Columbia and also a Senior Fellow at the Columbia Journalism School. He's the founder and editor of the award-winning website opencanada.org. He heads the International Relations and Digital Technology Research Project, and he sits on the Board of Directors of the Center for International Governance Innovation. Welcome. And finally, we're very, very pleased to welcome Deborah Seward. She is director of the Strategic Communications Division in the United Nations Department of Public Information. Before joining the UN, she spent more than 20 years with the Associated Press, serving in Moscow, Paris, Warsaw, Berlin, and New York. And she also served as director of the Central Newsroom at Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty in Prague from 2006 to 2007. Wonderful to have you with us. Deborah Seward. I'd like to start out by asking each of you to talk a little bit about how digital connectivity is challenging power. And I'll go first to you, Nik Gowing. You authored a study for the Reuters Institute with the very compelling title, Sky Full of Lies and Black Swans. It posits nothing less than a new tyranny of information power. Tell us something about how that is reshaping diplomacy.
Thank you, Melinda, and good morning, everybody. Sky Full of Lies was written 7 years ago. It was published 6 years ago. It warned about everything that's happening now, and most people rejected it. Sky Full of Lies was taken from the Burmese government, Myanmar government, when in 2007, during those extraordinary protests, particularly by the monks on the streets of Rangoon and Mandalay, we saw the first real idea of what transparency in a crisis is about, because you had people taking enormous risks, all of which was in a marvelous film as well, to film what was happening on their mobile phones, very granular now compared to all the phones you're using at the moment. But that stuff was got out. People were sentenced for up to 25 years in jail for doing it. But the government then said, it's not happening. It's a sky full of lies. In other words, what was being seen publicly and digitally was a lie. Now, the Syrian government did the same thing over many of the horrors which have been taking place in the last 3 or 4 years. They've now given me the title of my next book, so no one pinch it, please. They called it a tsunami of lies of what's coming out of Syria. But what we're seeing, and the reason why I say that is because, for example, in Burma now, Thein Sein, the president, has been told that you've got 14 wars going on in your country. And every one of them will now be visible because there are now two big circuits, telco circuits, which are being built by two big telecommunications companies. Everything will be visible. Everything will be accountable. My very strong view, based on an enormous amount of work that I've been doing, both when I was still on air at the BBC and now for King's and also for the Reuters Institute and ongoing, is that every government, every corporate is struggling to cope with this. They have not seen the inevitability, and we haven't seen anything yet. Vivek Kundra, the former chief technology officer at the White House, said, we've only really seen 0.001% of the enormity of digital change, which is affecting empowerment, and therefore affecting the legitimacy and the view and the perception of the legitimacy of those in power. And I say this, it's a sweeping statement, but almost no one in power really gets the enormity of how the digital space is turning what I call the public information space on its head. Those at the bottom now have more control than those at the top. And what we're seeing is a fragility of the systems of power, both in diplomacy internationally and even domestically for so many reasons. One final thought at this stage. Think of what happened on Mount Everest during the appalling earthquake in Nepal. The fact is, there were the climbers, they were filming what was happening as the avalanches came in. Not only did we see that in real time, but also they were tweeting. We knew where many of the climbers were. There was bandwidth up there. It didn't take several days for something to be shipped down the mountain. So very quickly we knew what was happening. Transpose what's happening on Everest at 12,000 feet to what's happening anywhere in the world, including the south of North Korea at the moment, and you see a transparent environment which those who've been elected or those who are more authoritarian believe they control, but they no longer control. And this is a real tension. It's causing many in positions of power and responsibility, particularly in foreign policy, to be overwhelmed and destabilized by the fact that they pull the levers and they discover very little happens.
Taylor Owen, Nik Gowing has just told us almost nobody gets it. Your own book is called The Crisis of the State in the Digital Age. I take it you agree that the state is failing the test that it's being put to at the moment.
Yeah, I do. And I think it's in part because the state faced a particularly unique challenge in this space. So I agree with Nick that digital technology isn't about necessarily just changing communication patterns. It's about a shift in the organization and the structure of power, away from hierarchical institutions, which dominated the 20th century, whether they be corporations, media companies, governments, international organizations like the UN, towards networked and collaborative power structures. The problem the states, and the key thing that transition, that makes this difference is that these hierarchical institutions have lost the monopoly they used to have over collaborative action, right? It used to be you needed big institutions to make lots of people do things. And that's just not the case anymore. And this is a fundamental threat to these institutions. States, though, I think, face a different dilemma. Unlike in the private sector, so if you're a large corporation and you're encumbered by your structure, by your lethargy, by your slow evolution, by your hierarchy, nimble startups can take you on and you can go out of business. And we've built an economic system that allows that. That's not the case for governments, right? Governments and states have a different role in our society. We've designed them to provide collective social goods. So they can't go away. So the risk is if they don't transition, not that they disappear, because that's not going to happen, it's that they become less efficient and less effective. So that should be a real problem for us. The second challenge states face, which is different than these other institutions, is in this digital space of empowerment, the same things that empower what states perceive as negative actors, so the terrorist organizations using social media, the black market websites trading drugs online, whatever they may be, are empowered by the very same capabilities and technologies that empower the things we might think of as positive online. The digital commerce, the free expression, the activism, they use the exact same tools. And the problem for governments is that the things you have to do to stop the negative actors will also stop the positive actors and will essentially break this digital space, will break the internet. So they're in this dilemma that I'm not sure they're well positioned to get out of.
I want to talk a bit later about what those things are that you might do to try to stop such actors. But Absolutely. Let me ask you, Deborah Seward, because certainly in my experience, the UN is a rather hierarchical institution. It is not a state, of course. But what kind of challenges does all this pose for an international organization like the United Nations? How is communications practice within your division changing?
Well, I think one of the things that one can say about the UN is that it is becoming more open because it has people like me in it, who joined as a journalist after more than 30 years and can now have an opportunity to try to help and shape these information and communications possibilities. But I think that one of the big challenges, and there are four of them, there's a tremendous amount of information that is coming in from different sources. And if the UN formally got its information from its staff on the ground or the member states, it now has to take into account information that is coming from all over, from different parts. And that must lead invariably to a greater need for accountability, because you cannot deny what some of the things that are coming in on pictures from Burundi from that tell you what your staff member tells you may be different from what somebody may be sending you in as a picture that you receive on Twitter. So I think there's that. But I think that the other thing is that we now have many, many partners to find the solutions. People are still looking toward the UN to craft solutions, but those solutions can no longer be crafted by the UN itself, by its staff itself. You have to be open and take into account and look and discuss with many more people than you might have before.
Thank you very much. Dunja Mijatovic, what about the OSCE? What is changing in the way that you communicate, in the way that the organization is working as a result of new digital technologies?
Well, before I tell you about the experience, my office, I have to say that I do not act as a spokesperson of the organization. I do not represent that part of structure. My office is in charge of media freedom. And it's quite unique, so that's why I think it's important to mention that it's the only intergovernmental media watchdog, and we look at the issues of safety of journalists, and here I come to our topic. When it comes to safety, what we notice for many years now, that internet, so cyberspace, is becoming a new battlefield for freedom. Why? It's because bloggers, social media activists, in many authoritarian regimes are becoming enemies of the state, and the internet in a way, or surveillance, is used in order to track these people, to imprison them, to threaten them, to harass them, and this is the challenge that we have. What it presents for my office in order to reach out for these people, it's source of information, but it also presents a way of dealing with the governments directly. With the Twitter account, I opened it 2013, which is my office's account, is the OSCE Freedom of Media office account. I do interact with foreign ministers, with authorities, in order to raise a little red flag and say, don't do this. This is not something that is in compliance with the OSCE Media Freedom commitments. But at the same time, I use it as a way to be quicker and to talk about certain issues that it would take much longer if we would use all traditional ways of dealing with international organizations or with the governments. Digital diplomacy, I would even say virtual diplomacy, is a huge challenge for diplomats because of huge exposure. We are all more exposed to the outside world, and that is something that presents extremely important issue. We are becoming more transparent, we are becoming more reachable, but then at the same time more accountable. I get questions like, why didn't you raise an issue of the journalists being beaten in Bosnia and Herzegovina, which is my own country? And then we can immediately reply. We are looking into the case, we are trying to raise it. For example, the issue of Al Jazeera journalist that was arrested here in Germany was something that was mainly over the weekend discussed on a Twitter account. And I had a statement and there was a response by the German government. So in the traditional world, or 10 years or even 20 years ago, something like that wouldn't be possible. And that is why I think we need to use it for the benefit. But at the same time, I think that this cannot in any way replace all traditional diplomacy on issues that are a challenge of our times.
Many thanks. And in fact, that example of the Al Jazeera journalist is a very good one to see the pressure for speedy action that results. He was released today. So in fact, there have been results from that campaign. Jan Melissen, your institute and you have done a great deal of work looking at how traditional actors are responding and using digital technologies. What would you say about who is making the most effective and creative use of these new tools? Is it Vladimir Putin, Yanis Varoufakis, Victoria Nuland? Who do you think is doing this right? Nik Gowing has told us a lot of them are doing it wrong. Who's doing it right?
No, they haven't caught up yet.
Thank you very much. Yes, I certainly think that question deserves attention. First of all, thanks very much for having me here and meeting so many people who are very knowledgeable about these issues. I see myself as an ordinary man getting used to the digital age, and I'm doing nothing but meeting people who are in more or less the same position, and institutions who are in more or less the same position. So how do we react to this in a creative way, in a positive way? And the reaction, I think, is in many ways comparable to the reaction of the rise of public diplomacy, where we could see there was a lot of hype, and then gradually acceptance and mainstreaming of practices in institutions. The same with digital. So what does it mean? Here, what one could compare the reaction to earlier technological revolutions, the invention of the electric telegraph, for instance, where Lord Palmerston famously said, this is the end of diplomacy. Well, I think we can, so many years after, conclude this is not the end of diplomacy. And that was actually repeated at the time of WikiLeaks, when an Italian foreign minister said, this is the end of diplomacy as we know it. It is not, but diplomacy is changing, and how is it changing, and how indeed can diplomats and foreign ministries and governments make creative use of these tools? Your question reveals one thing to my mind, and that is that there has been quite a lot of focus on leaders, celebrities, the very famous people. And of course, there is one company who has even invented a name, Twi Diplomacy, for the phenomenon that political leaders are manifest themselves very actively on the internet, where there is some kind of competition going on with the Pope having 6.3 million followers, President Erdogan, 6.5 million followers. Well, what does it really mean? Of course, we're all a bit trapped in the situation that we know that followers are not important at all. But still, it says something about your muscle size when you can show a decent number of followers. So how is it changing diplomacy? When you look at what diplomacy is all about, you see that it enters all the key functions of diplomacy and are all related to digital. Diplomacy, to many people's minds, is about negotiation. And we've heard examples also yesterday about the Iran nuclear talks where digital creeps in. It's about communication, it's about representation, and more recently, because we live in the age of the ordinary individual, and the ordinary individual wants to be helped now by government, we see that digital also creeps in other services in diplomacy, like consular diplomacy. Nepal, the Nepal example was mentioned by Nick. People want to be helped instantly. And you see that governments, with such crisis, go on the internet instantly, go on Twitter to help their citizens. So that, I think, is a positive example. Another one might be, and we could turn later to that in the discussion, that in public diplomacy, there is much more potential to outreach. Actually, people can see what diplomats are doing, which what they could not before. And one of the interesting phenomena, effects of the digital age is perhaps that we see diplomats making mistakes. And there is even a Twitter handle that is putting on Twitter all the deleted tweets by diplomats, that's what they claim, all over the world. We see how successive ambassadors are compared. How are they doing the social media? So people feel very exposed, and there's a pressure to become more creative. Now, I would single out one area where I see this very creative use of digital diplomacy, and that's in the field of campaigns on human rights. This is also where you see how diplomacy is changing. It's becoming much more dependent on working with other actors, on working with civil society. It's becoming much more open. And that's what diplomats have to get used to. It's changing the rules of the game, and more openness is something that, in a profession which is depending on confidentiality by nature, more openness is what diplomats have to turn to. On the human rights example, one example would be the campaign.
Let's come back to that in just a moment. Let's stay with the point about diplomacy and openness. Many diplomats, of course, would say they know far too much about what we're doing now. You mentioned the diplomat who said diplomacy is dead after WikiLeaks. Nik Gowing, the pressure for credibility, the pressure for accountability, once that credibility is lost, is it permanent? Is it gone forever? Has the U.S. really seen such damage due to WikiLeaks that you would say their foreign policy has been harmed in the long run?
There are different views about that, but these are kind of ephemeral things. I think it does, as Jan said, it does create an imperative on accountability. And those that tweet and those that go into the public space much quicker, like Tom Fletcher, the British ambassador in Lebanon, he's shown how it can be done. But they're taking a risk, and there are other diplomats who've lost their jobs or been demoted for what they've tweeted about. It's also happened in our business. Let's not mention any names of those who've tweeted and actually then ended up losing their careers as well. But there's a far broader issue. On WikiLeaks, let's get it right as well. It showed the wisdom of diplomats. Many diplomats have been shown to be totally correct in their analysis, which is what has upset many of the host nations. So what we're seeing is a high class of diplomat, and I think Snowden is a completely separate issue to Twitter and the new transparency in the what we might call the crisis space. What I think Jan is getting at, and what I see very sharply, is the way this puts stuff on the agenda very quickly. And I would take issue with Catherine yesterday, who talked about that something must be done. I actually did a study at Harvard many years ago. Something must be done. A decision by a government to do something can actually be to do as little as possible. So just because it's visible in the public space doesn't mean to say that you're actually going to then end up with a very assertive policy. We saw that in Britain during the after the August 21 chemical weapons attacks in Damascus, where there was real pressure to take action against the Syrians, to launch airstrikes and so on. And we saw the public in Britain, when Parliament was recalled, I mentioned this in another session yesterday, when Parliament was recalled, the public got to the MPs and the MPs didn't act as the Prime Minister wanted, and a decision was taken not to act against Syria. So the public is now driving a lot of this, whether it be the visibility through Twitter or there are new developments. Already, Twitter is already one element of this. Look at the proliferation of drones now. You can buy for $100 an HD drone and you can fly over a war zone. That's going to be a problem for NATO when it deploys, if it has to deploy in large numbers into the Baltics and eastern Poland. Everything will be visible from up there. We're seeing it in Ukraine at the moment. These are massively changing times. To then put pressure, and it's not just diplomats, it's actually public officials, public servants, and ministers as well, to respond, react, and have a view and enter the space. And many in most countries feel very uncomfortable about that until they know fully what's taking place.
So Taylor Owen, it sounds like Nik Gowing is suggesting that there are, in a way, two contradictory trends that are occurring here. One is there's a pressure to, for action, for action's sake, to simply do something and be seen to be doing something. And on the other hand, often a very slow response, not getting out in front of the message, but just providing little salami slices of truth or untruth in reaction. How do those play out in terms of the effectiveness of diplomats and foreign policymakers?
I mean, one place you can see this tension is in our tendency to categorize all of digital diplomacy initiatives under the public diplomacy category, right? So we often say that really digital Twitter is just about communicating foreign policy, and it's about foreign ministers on Twitter or foreign ministers doing town halls on YouTube, and these are definitely just continuations, I think, of this space of public diplomacy, of communicating government policy. But a whole host of other things governments are doing under the bucket of digital diplomacy are actually much more assertive acts of foreign policy. They're actually making foreign policy in the digital space, not just communicating it. And when they do this, they often get into trouble, right? And this is where the tension really emerges. So look at what the US government, for example, has been doing in Syria. So if we're saying that digital activity is an act of making foreign policy, then in any one location, we have to evaluate it alongside other acts of making foreign policy, other military acts, other development acts, other trade acts. And in Syria, you end up in some awkward positions, right? So the US government, under digital diplomacy initiatives, is giving encryption technology and mesh networking capability to activists and rebel groups, right? To allow them to circumvent the surveillance of the Assad regime. Well, the Assad regime is using surveillance technology that was built in the United States and traded out of the United States. And other parts of the US government are actively trying to break encryption, the very technology that the State Department, through digital diplomacy initiatives, is giving some Syrian rebels to protect them from the Assad regime using devices made in the United States, right? So this tension is, it's a very convoluted space, and I think we need to treat digital diplomacy as this assertive act in this space, not as just communicating and new forms of communicating foreign policy.
Dunja Mijatovic, you recently retweeted, I guess you're tweeting right now, you recently retweeted an article with some rather chilling and troubling examples of Twi diplomacy. One that was mentioned was the French diplomat who was trapped under gunfire in a Copenhagen cafe who tweeted that he was still alive in the room. Clearly you retweeted that because you saw it as a kind of warning, I guess, for other practitioners of diplomacy.
Absolutely. I mean, that's just one of the examples where social media or this exposure or tweeting or using the tools that we have at our disposal at the moment might help save people's lives. But at the same time, also sending a message in a very difficult time for the French diplomat, for example, He would not be able to do this if there is no this possibility. We can also ask ourselves, is this good or bad? But we also have to be very careful when we talk about diplomats or government officials using Twitter. There is a catch there. Those Twitter accounts, really Twitter accounts controlled by those individuals, or there are teams of people working for them. There are big differences. For example, Carl Bildt, former foreign minister of Sweden, definitely is the only person working on his Twitter account, as we many of us know this. But for many other diplomats, I'm not sure if this is really them engaging with public, with journalists, with other government officials. And sometimes you see if the tweets are very cautious and very sort of wrapped up, you see it's not really the person, it's the team working behind this Twitter account or Facebook account recently. And I'm asked often by journalists, so when you reply on Twitter, is that you or somebody from your staff? And what I can say, I have two members of my staff working with me on the account, but when it comes to the engagement and replies, it's always me. So we need to also recognize that there are different ways of dealing with social media. But there are so many statements and talks, and you just mentioned that somebody said the moment WikiLeaks was exposed, there is no more diplomacy. Lord Palmerston in 1860 said there is no more diplomacy when he received the first telegraph in 1860. So no matter which device or which platform is challenging power in a way, we will be surprised and we will not know how to deal with this. But what I see most of the time in too many countries, and here I'm not talking just about 57 of the OSCE, there is a big fear behind it, how to deal with it, how to secure, how to make possible that there is a control. And what we have also present, which is a huge challenge that we didn't mention today, are trolls. Trolls that are really, doing more. That in relation to Ukraine crisis, what we have on our accounts, the OSCE accounts, is trolls really trying to move direction in some other areas. So we need to be accepting the challenge and embracing the benefits. How to do this is a challenge of our times, but I'm always for more exposure because I think it brings benefits more than anything else.
I want to come right back to responses to manipulation of media, for example, in the Ukraine crisis. But Deborah Seward, perhaps one more word on diplomats and tweet diplomacy. Is there an inherent risk simply because of the form of this communication? Bold and pithy would be a nice way to describe it, but another one, of course, is very simplistic and always tending to be polemical. That is quite the opposite of traditional diplomatic language. Is it a very risky area per se for diplomats?
I think it's a very risky area, but I think if we look at it in a different way, it provides a tremendous opportunity, because I think we have to look at not just what is being tweeted or put out, but how you listen. And that is what is forcing diplomats to change, is normally they would be conversing among themselves. Now they have to listen to what it is that people are saying to them and develop the response. That is a tremendous opportunity to learn. That's a tremendous opportunity, as I said before, to craft new solutions. I think one of the challenges for diplomats as well is that they have had to change their language. They have to get out of their jargon. They have to get out of their acronyms. They have to talk as the way that you and I talk. And this is actually a good thing because it helps people understand what it is that they are really trying to do. And that is, but to come back to your question is yes, they see it as a risk because they've never had to talk to anybody except necessarily in closed situations. But they're capable of it. And I think that if you start to use language differently, It helps you think differently. And that is a good thing. So I'm not trying to put only a rosy face on it, but it is, and Dunja and I were talking about this early, it is critical for us, and the WikiLeaks shows us some of the vulgarity. It shows us, as Nik said, some of the good things that diplomats do, but it means that we have to communicate in a very different way. But I think that there is, if I go think about the issue of confidentiality, which is really what you're getting out, the word confidence comes from the same root. And we have to open up and give the diplomats, because it's not going away, they have to be able to become more confident to operate in this space so that they can interact with each other and with others.
Jan Melissen, you have taken a look at some of the constraints that foreign ministries, for example, cite in trying to explain why they're not adapting more effectively. Tell us a bit about why they are so risk-averse and why that learning curve is so steep, as you've described it.
Yes, well, the learning curve is indeed very steep, and we're talking about individuals who, in the daily pressures of their workplace, have to adapt to digital. Now, what you see a lot is that adaptation to digital is analog behavior in a digital age. Many diplomats actually use their Twitter to look for information. So they're trying to stay anonymous, as they have been for centuries, since time immemorial. So there's definitely that trend among foreign policy practitioners to sort of stay out of in the shadow. That said, we see that there is a drive towards adaptation, and that drive towards adaptation, which I think is an underlying issue that Taylor has already alluded to, is that, and that other speakers have alluded to, is that the environment forces foreign ministries and diplomats to change their behavior. It's no longer a hierarchical state-based environment, it's a networked environment. And as was just said, in that network environment, you don't play by your rules. No, those who are in your network have their own language, they have their own norms and value, and foreign ministries and governments are increasingly dependent on collaborating with outside actors. So you really see that there is a very fundamental change underlying digital, but amplified by digital, an underlying change in how diplomacy functions. One could say networking is the second nature of diplomats, and it has always been. But that's very different from saying that networking as an activity is at the foundation of diplomacy today. It's a conceptual basis of diplomacy as an activity. And that's where digital comes in, and that's where it's very tempting, what I call the Nescafe school people, who say, oh, technology is driving politics and all that, but there's more going on. The structures of diplomacy itself are changing.
Nik Gowing.
Yeah, I fully agree with Jan. We're talking about accountability. We're talking about vulnerability. We're talking about the danger of deficit of legitimacy. And two examples, Russia. Russia's been well ahead of the game. We are losing the game there with Russia. And Russia has been thinking about this for a long time. There's been denial, and this is one of my other 6 points. Mindset, behavior, denial. Denial that Russia would ever get back to where it is on information warfare. Denial, too, that a group that no one had really ever heard of this time 15 months ago, say, like Daesh. Daesh is an Islamic caliphate which is based on the digital power. No one, even in intelligence services, believed that was possible. We're talking about dramatic changes, changes which might have happened in 10 years and now happening in 10 months or 10 weeks. It's that fast, and changing the mindset. This is not about criticism. We in our business, in broadcasting and journalists, we've got to change damn fast as well. So it's not unique. We're not throwing stones at diplomats and public servants. Everyone is having to change in this diplomatic space. But imagine Rwanda, 1994. If there'd been Twitter and mobile phones. Rwanda, now the most digitally connected country alongside Finland and Korea. Imagine that happening now, 800,000 people killed. What would have been the impact there? And there are many other examples as well. This is now about the end of the controlled space, because those in government who have to make decisions, very difficult decisions, particularly about warfare, and if you want to move on to what might happen in Eastern Europe with an Article 5 intervention, we can. But it's the end of the controlled space. If you fire a multiple launch rocket system into the distance, someone will be at the other end with a camera, and that damage and the collateral damage and the death will be visible very quickly. That immediately has an effect on a policy. It's the same with Syrian barrel bombs. When a barrel bomb is thrown out of a helicopter somewhere in Homs or Aleppo, that is now seen. That is now building up a case. So that means that lawfare, L-A-W, lawfare is now becoming a critical part of the armory. And this is now leading to risk aversion and constraint and restraint when it comes to policymaking.
I want to come back to digital diplomacy in situations of conflict, but one follow-up question on this point of diplomacy having to change. Nonetheless, diplomats also have to do some of their very traditional time-honored tasks at the same time, namely negotiate new trade agreements, for example. We've seen tremendous pressure from grassroots groups, particularly here in Germany in the course of the TTIP negotiations, saying, but this has been done in secret, these negotiations are not transparent. Is it possible to conduct negotiations on a sensitive treaty as transparently as digital grassroots organizations would like to see?
Well, I think Jan and others need to respond to that. But for me, this digital space is about our feet as journalists being held to the fire. Quite often we're found to be not as right as we thought we would be. That's great for journalism, it's great for transparency, and it's great for the citizens who are out there, often in very difficult circumstances. So, you know, if the public is now getting engaged, this is about a new form of political relationship between those who govern and those who are governed. And that's very slow. The adaptation is very slow. And you're seeing that in China with the constraints now being put on Sina Weibo. The survival of the party there is now conditional on how they can control the proliferation of mobile phones. And when they've got almost 600,000 masts in China, in some of the most remote places as well, this is a real challenge to those who believe that they can run the country on their terms. And I'm saying that emblematically because many countries in Africa are looking at what we're talking about here, working out how much they can control what is happening in the public space as they move and develop, and with a young population.
Taylor Wynne.
Yeah, just on the transparency of diplomacy in these spaces of privacy, I mean, WikiLeaks was in many cases a radical pushback against over-secrecy, right? About too much being confidential and too much being private. But no one is ultimately saying that nothing can be private and that there's no effectiveness in doing things in private spaces. And I think there's nothing, and there's nothing wrong with saying that these things can exist in tandem, that more of our diplomatic and government activity should be transparent, and yet there should be spaces of confidentiality and privacy. The flip side of that, though, is that we as populations are being told that large-scale surveillance systems, which fundamentally take away our spaces of privacy, should be okay as long as we have nothing to hide, as long as we're not doing anything wrong. So those spaces of fundamental privacy are being taken away from citizens at the same time as they're being preserved by institutions. And I don't think that imbalance can exist for much longer.
Thank you very much. I'd like to, Jan Melissen, you had a comment, sorry.
Very briefly on the point regarding the nature of negotiations, how that has changed. We still tend to imagine a negotiation as something that's taking place in rooms that are no longer smoke-filled, but nevertheless with people around a table. And that is fundamentally changing. The whole process of what's called in the literature pre-negotiation, or as what one author called circumnegotiation, everything that's going around on around is much more important. So negotiations is not so much what's happening at the table, but framing the issues in the whole wider process involving all the actors that states and international organizations need, because they have knowledge, they have access, they can provide the legitimacy to deals. So it's a changing game, it's a much more open game.
Framing the issues is a good bridge, perhaps, to go over in order to get to the use of digital technologies in conflict situations, because certainly manipulation of media framing has been a huge part of what's been happening in Ukraine. Dunja Mijatovic, are open societies at a comparative disadvantage here in comparison to closed ones, to the extent that open societies at least claim to be transparent and therefore are perhaps more vulnerable to charges that they're not being?
It's on. Complex question. With internet, those lines and borders are blurred. And what we have, for example, in Ukraine is a huge effect that propaganda can have on minds and lives of people. What I said on several occasions, I think that propaganda that is used as a moment is very ugly scar on the face of modern journalism. And it's something that is challenging all journalists and media around the world in order how to really respond to these challenges. And Nick just mentioned that we are losing and Russia is winning when it comes to, you know, sending the message and having an effect on people's lives, but I'm not sure about it. I come from part of the world where propaganda played enormous role and actually injected hatred among people, division, and all these things, and there was no internet. So you do not need internet in order to affect people's lives. Of course, it's a different platform that we have at the moment. But when it comes to open societies, I would say that there are also huge challenges there if we talk about digital diplomacy or internet in general. The challenges are because of security issues, because democratic governments are also making very wrong steps in order to address these issues. They are introducing the laws all in the name of security issues, all in the name of fight against terrorism, not thinking how these laws will affect freedom of speech and freedom of the media. And not only that, there are attempts to over-regulate. There are decisions made even by the European Court of Human Rights the other week on giving really a role to internet service providers to regulate content. How this is going to affect not just e-diplomacy, but interactions in cyberspace, it's very difficult to say at this stage. But the challenges are of different kind in the open societies and the regimes that are different or in times of conflict like we have in Ukraine. But at the same time, there are some challenges that are really the same, and that is how to keep internet safe and free and not fragmented. And we see this constantly happening in even, you know, parts of the world or in countries you would not expect to engage with this. And that's why in my role as the OSCE representative on freedom of the media, I'm very blunt in pointing to the governments, particularly the democratic ones, because I think they should use by example and should not slide down in this, it is really very important to say that the challenges are great, but at the same time, we cannot fight any threats in our society if we put human rights under the table.
Deborah Seward, what do you believe that policymakers, diplomats can do to really confront manipulation of media, either by authoritarian regimes or by non-state actors like Daesh, ISIS, who of course are making very sophisticated use of these technologies?
I think this is an essential point, and it goes back to fact-checking. I think that international organizations have resources, and they have a responsibility, because what we face when we are trying to craft a response, and that is the challenge of international organizations, is that the situation is made known to you very quickly. How do you craft that response that is adequate, that it does the job? And it comes back to straightforward fact-checking. This is really essential, because what is being put, we have to find out and figure out how to, what I would call, pierce the propaganda armor. And the way that you do that and give confidence to societies that are under threat from whatever it may be or do not have freedom, is through this fact-checking, which is why organizations like the UN, Human Rights, OSCE, when they, you cannot replace what goes on the ground to see what is happening and what is going on and to report back. Because your job as the international community is to help these communities that are under threat, and you must make this response, and you cannot do it if it is not based on accurate information, facts. So the things that brought journalism 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 50 years ago, they go back to the initial values, and I think that that is where there is a contribution to be made. It's difficult, but it is really essential, because what is being put out there are various levels of reality, and there cannot be three realities. And that is what one of the things that we really have to work on and work on together.
Nico?
This is critical, but it's the heart of the contradiction and the tension here, which I've written about and identified over the years, and for which there's been a lot of resistance by what I would call the flat earthers inside governments and policymakers. It's the fact that the public can now consume everything virtually immediately on this. Governments and government systems cannot work at that speed, neither can corporate chief executives. And so there's a gap there, which is what I've called the F1, the F3 dilemma, which is you can be fast into the space, you can be first into the space, but how flawed are you? How wrong are you? And if you're flawed as a public servant, you've got to get it right, and you've got to defend why you were wrong, because the public will say, we can see it all going on, why are we not hearing from those in positions of power? It's an irreconcilable tension, but this is why I talk about the deficit of legitimacy. Because the public is saying, we can see what's happening, why aren't we hearing from the policymakers? Surely they're hiding something. And the longer that goes on, half an hour, 2 hours into a crisis, that deficit of legitimacy increases. But it's a very practical restriction on policymakers. They can't necessarily know what is happening. They've got to check. They've got to verify, as we always do on air, with anything that's coming in. But when you've got 300 hours of video being posted every minute on YouTube, there's a massive problem of vigilation of what is coming in if you're a policymaker.
Jan Melissen, you have done some work with China. Perhaps you could briefly share your impressions there in regard to open and closed societies and use of digital technologies. To phrase it as Nik Gowing did at the outset, does the Chinese government get it?
Whether they get it is a difficult question. They do put a lot of money into it, more actually than any other country in the whole wide world. So for them, doing public diplomacy is closely tied to the strategic objectives of their government, the strategic foreign policy objectives. And you now see also in Europe, also at the EU level, a certain response to that. Perhaps we have to think in the same strategic ways and see how public diplomacy is connected to more broader foreign policy objectives. Are they getting it right? Is a very difficult question. Twitter, of course, is forbidden in China. At the same time, you see how Chinese missions in the rest of the world start using Twitter, start using these social networking sites, these platforms. So they're playing a double game, and they're also getting that if you want to be successful as a Chinese diplomat in the Western world, your public diplomacy should not just be one of broadcasting, but should be one more of dialogue. And this is, for instance, where we see in response to the criticism of the Confucius Institutes, that the Chinese start realizing, hey, we have to set up other types of platforms. So there is this duality there as to Western operations in China. It's, of course, absolutely phenomenal for Western embassies how they can use Sina Weibo, how they have an outreach into Chinese society that was inconceivable before. So you really see that on both sides there is, there are new tools that they can use in fantastic ways. In China, of course, well, it's a different kind of society, a different form of government. At the same time, you see that there is a big debate going on inside China on public diplomacy within the constraints of an authoritarian state, and as an authoritarian state that would like to be, to exercise a sort of responsive authoritarianism, they are coping with, in other circumstances, with similar pressures. The digital age exists for China as much as it does for the West.
Taylor Wan, you had a comment.
Yeah, on this question of autocratic versus democratic responses to this, I mean, first it's worth reinforcing that they're both threatened in to varying degrees by new forms of civic engagement, right? So they're both threatened by the digital space to some degree, and they're both using similar technologies to fight back, right? So there's similarities of in kind anyway, if not degree. But the other thing worth pointing out here, I think, is, and the big question for democracies, is with the new tools governments are using and with the new capabilities they're deploying in the digital space, whether it's artificial intelligence or algorithmic governance decisions based on huge data sets, how do we bring the values that we embedded in those institutions, those democratic state institutions, into this digital space? What does it mean to hold a very complex algorithm to account, an unknowable machine learning system that we don't even know who created or how it evolved over time? How do we hold that to account? And these are the types of questions, I think, in the democratic space that we have to grapple with. They're not easy. These are very complex systems that governments are deploying to control and to govern in the digital space.
Dunja Mijatovic, you had a comment, I think.
Just on understanding of digital diplomacy by some governments. Some governments, in my view, see digital diplomacy as a potential exercise how to move their control from normal, ordinary life to cyberspace. And they are using enormous amount of funds in order to filter, to block websites. And this is based on experience I have in my daily work, unfortunately, that many governments calling themselves democratic governments are engaging, and I'm here talking about 57 states. We often say about ourselves that we are a club of democracies. But I strongly disagree, because democracies do not do these things in relation to free speech and freedom of the media that I'm now experiencing for almost 6 years in doing this job. My answer to those governments is always to use those funds in order to put it in the internet and media literacy, and not in order to filter people's brains. I do not think any democratic government was elected in order to try to filter people's brains. And instead of engaging with the public, they try to control it using social media. And that is something that we are also dealing with nowadays. I would also mention something that is quite not topic of our discussion, but it's very much connected. Journalists that are working using social media, engaging with diplomats as well, and it depends really which country, are facing huge threats. And we recently noticed that female journalists exposing corruption, crime of many governments are brutally attacked, and they have to close their Twitter accounts, their Facebook accounts, and they, in a way, go underground in order to do these things. So social media is also a tool where you can, that you can really use in order to threaten people. There are rape threats, death threats, and we are documenting this at the moment as an office and trying to engage with other international organizations, because it is social phenomena that we need to pay more attention to.
Thank you very much. Nik Gowing, would you say that the use of the new technologies is widening or shrinking the space for quality journalism to affect foreign policy?
I wouldn't want to talk about quality journalism. For me, it's about the public information space and the amount of good information that's out there, which includes journalism. I think it is shrinking, because I've already said it's about changing the nature of a controlled space, which governments, and it's beyond diplomacy, governments tend to assume is theirs because they are the elected or appointed representatives of the people. When it comes to China, I'd like to go further than Yan, because I think this is indicative of what you're asking. They are concerned that they will not be able to maintain the supremacy of the party, and that's why they're constantly trying to hammer away at and limit the ability of Sina Weibo. If you post certain things on Sina Weibo now, you can end up on a criminal charge. I had a unique experience almost 2 years ago. I ended up giving a presentation in the school of the Chinese Communist Party. We didn't know it at the time, and this was about exactly what we're talking about here, about the new vulnerability, the new accountability. And there were stony faces. They'd invited us. It was even until a few hours before we actually did this, and there were several of us who did it, there was that sense of, will it actually happen? That this was 10 days before Xi Jinping and the Standing Committee then made their very clear statement that they would want to control the public information space and the digital space. But it hasn't stopped things like the explosion in Tiananmen Square being seen on Sina Weibo and 10 minutes later being taken down. That confirmed that there had been a bomb attack with an SUV with the Uyghurs. Same with what's happening up in Xinjiang, up in Urumqi, when there have been a significant number of marketplace attacks and so on. Those are the kind of things which would never have emerged except by rumor a few days later. Now it's in there and up there within 10 minutes or even 2 minutes, and that's forcing accountability. Therefore, I put that onto the table because that's emblematic of the difficulty for any country which wants to believe it can control all of this on its terms. They can't. Whether that's quality journalism or not, doesn't matter. It's the fact that the raw material is out there in the public space very quickly.
Thank you very much. I want to come right away to audience questions, but just one last question to you, Deborah Seward, in regard to broad human rights-oriented campaigns like the ones that Jan Melissen mentioned at the outset of his remarks. Certainly, digital technologies allow these kind of campaigns to just take off and become not only viral, but global. I'm thinking, for example, of the Bring Back Our Girls hashtag campaign after the Boko Haram kidnapping of those 200 schoolgirls. Lots of outrage vented, but does it really promote a solution, or is it a kind of a huge affect-based campaign that then doesn't really go anywhere?
That is a very good question. And it goes back to what I was telling you a little bit before about the listening and the learning. I mean, what did we learn from that campaign? We learned that that campaign went global, that the world expected a solution for Nigeria. It was a wake-up call to the Nigerian government that it would not simply be able to ignore this issue. There are other girls who have been kidnapped, there are others, that they had actually to take account for this and to reach out to others who could try to find a solution for that. We've seen that with other human rights campaigns, is that the member states of large intergovernmental organizations don't exist in isolation anymore. They have to work with their neighbors. They have to work with international organizations. And it won't go away. I mean, it's gone down a little bit, the campaign, but it certainly hasn't gone away. And it certainly at least puts the issue in the places that they are not alone and that they can reach out for solutions. But if you'll permit me for just a second, this debate and this discussion has naturally focused on peace and security and human rights. But there are diplomats that are operating in another space, particularly in development, humanitarian affairs, and that is where the digital space can actually help provide solutions. Mm-hmm. Is that if you take, for example, the upcoming Summit on Sustainable Development, if you take next year's World Humanitarian Summit, those are places where the UN and other international organizations might have said, here are goals for you, that we have developed for you. Now it is here are goals that we, in the large sense, have developed for us. And that, in that sense, the digital diplomacy, the digital ability to survey citizens is changing the way that big summits, big negotiations, not necessarily on peace and security, but on other issues, are having to take into account and change the way that the UN and other international organizations do their business.
Not to mention NGOs' ability right. to monitor whether governments are actually keeping the promises they make at those upcoming summits. Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to take your questions, but let's start out by getting a brief word from Yaakov about what's happening on our own Twitter account.
Well, thanks to many of you here and, of course, a lot of users around the globe. Global Media Forum is still among the most discussed topics on social media platforms, especially on Twitter. Just to mention really briefly before we go through some tweets that we already read more than 3,000 posts in English with the hashtag DW_GMF, although there are a lot of users also tweeting in Arabic and German. Long story short, in Germany, Global Media Forum is on the 7th place and for some reason, 2nd in Austria. Let's go through some tweets. Hamado tweeted following question, does number of followers on Twitter mean anything? Are leaders claiming millions of followers wasting time? Katie Burden believes that the states are failing in the digital age. He or his will become less effective because they're not designed to cope. An interesting thought posted by Regina Aguiare. Can you imagine there is a Twitter handle that claims to post all the deleted tweets of diplomats? Mina posted, we also need to keep in mind that the regimes are investing in social media not for the sake of engagement, but to mislead the people. Question coming from Matthias Lufkens. Will trolling and propaganda kill Twitter and digital diplomacy? One question addressed to Taylor Owen. Islamic State used hashtag of Global Media Forum yesterday. US said losing social media battle to IS. What diplomatic message would be more appealing? Luigi Di Martino also has a question. Diplomacy still needs a certain degree of confidentiality. How can this and transparency be balanced? What make a diplomatic social media strategy effective? And maybe one quite entertaining in the end. Maximiliana says, struggling with the sliding chair at the plenary chamber, boat leg syndrome after yesterday's news cruise. Sorry to hear that.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Let us take a few questions in the room as well, and then we'll pass them on. So I'll take these three right here, and then we'll take three more. I'll start with these three. Microphones. Do we have somebody with a mic to come to our question askers?
Hello, I'm here. Okay, I would like to share a bit.
Okay, please, if you want to ask your question, if you would care to go to the mic, then.
Okay, I'm allowed to, okay. My name is Zunar. I'm a political cartoonist from Malaysia. I want to share a very simple, very quick information about how the government of Malaysia using a Twitter to detain peoples. Like in my case, the Inspector General of Police give an instruction to his personnel to detain me using a Twitter. And then after a few hours, I was detained. And now I'm facing charges under Sedition Act. Just to show that how the government used Twitter to detain peoples in Malaysia. Yes.
Thank you for that. And we will take comments in a bit from the panelists, but let me get a few other questions and comments. And do tell us who you are, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Daya Tusu. I'm Professor of International Communication in London, University of Westminster. It's a comment rather than a question. One thing which has not been discussed at all is also the fact that most of this social media and the organizations which dominate it are essentially American. And as we have seen in recent years in relation to Snowden, there's an interesting convergence between the US government and new social media organization. That's point one. The other point I want to make, and I would be interested in the reflections from this very distinguished panel, about the nature of the internet itself, that the internet is fragmenting, there's talk of balkanization of the internet. Already China is the largest, has the largest users of internet in absolute numbers, followed by India, where the percentage of people who are online is only 24%. So just imagine what will happen when 90% of Indians and 90% of Chinese are online. What kind of internet will that be? In which language? Given that these two countries are also to the fastest growing economies with huge populations and massive global diasporas. So just like to have some reflections on that from the panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We'll pick up on that in a minute. Go ahead. Short question, if you would, there, please, and then we'll try to get to some other parts of the room.
Journalist from Libya. My question and the comment about the social media, the Facebook, and in the case of journalist Ahmed Mansour, who was detained by German authority, I'm surprised that the West has no tolerance for hate speech and citing for hatred and war crime, genocide, when it's published or broadcast in the Western media. But in case of Arab media, for example, Ahmed Mansour's Facebook page is full of hatred, libel, defamation, but no one cares. We remember in 2003 when Kilroy Selk was suspended from the BBC because of hate remarks. So unfortunately, the Facebook page and the Twitter of some leading Arab journalists is full of hate crimes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me go up here to the room here in the, the lady there, please.
Thank you very much to the very esteemed panel for your presentation. Mine is just the paradox of globalized digitalization. And I'm wondering, traditionally, power has been played by a small club bearing the privilege to impact decisions directly in the classical sense of democracy, of representative democracy. Now, the digital class, though open and broader, is yet another economically enhanced class existing in a seemingly open yet closed space. It's about access to the internet, involving money and e-gadgets, a catastrophe for the marginalized. Is hope for open, all-inclusive access dead for my countrymen and women in rural, marginalized economies? And then a comment for the organizers. I notice that the panel is very esteemed, and I appreciate that, and the depth of information coming from you. But there is no direct African representation, which is a shame. When Kenyans have engaged the ICC on Twitter and, changed the sphere of e-diplomacy, there should be African voices next time.
You are quite right. Thank you very much for that comment. Let me get a few comments now from our panelists, because we are coming very close to the end of our time, and I do want to let Nik Gowing make his plane. So let me get a few comments, and then we'll see if we can handle one more short round of questions. Nik, please.
I apologize, I've got to get a plane at 12 o'clock, so I have to leave literally at the top of the hour, so thank you, Miranda. 2 points. First of all, on that, I think if you talk to Jeff Sachs and others in the development community, what you're seeing is a leap over, and therefore the marginalized are marginalized maybe at the moment, but the level of connectivity is producing something very different, and I think you should be optimistic. On what Dyer has just said about America's dominance, I don't see that at all. You come, India. When you look at Anna Hazara, who managed to put digitally on the agenda within 96 hours the issue of corruption, which completely changed the political perspectives there. You also saw the Indian Foreign Ministry decide to grip the issue during the Libyan crisis of vast numbers, tens of thousands of Indian people who were marooned in Misrata. And the Indian, and this is a positive for how mindsets can change, and I know how this happened from personal experience, but mindsets can change very quickly when those at the top, like the Foreign Secretary of the Indian External Affairs Ministry, said, you've got to get this new technology. And within 3 months, there was a big crisis in northern Libya. India had to get tens of thousands of people out on boats and planes and so on. And that changed the perspective of the Indian population about the ability of the Indian government to handle. So there are positives in all of this, but I don't think that America, you should assume that America is dominating this at all.
Thank you very much.
Do you mind if I slip away?
Nik, we will let Nik Gowing go now and give him a round of applause. Thanks so much for being with us, and we'll continue right on with Deborah Seward.
I actually wanted to pick up on what Nik said, and in response to the gentleman from the University of Westminster. For example, the UN is in 6 different languages. I don't think it's English that's dominant. The issue is every day we have millions of tweets, Facebooks in Arabic, in Chinese, in Russian. It's how we are going to interact with them. There's a whole space out there that because of our own language limitations that we're not able to interact directly. But it's out there, and it's that's the imperative, if you will, of how to communicate, interact with all of these populations who are speaking a different language.
Do you want to say a word about digital equality or digital inequality?
Yes, I would. I think it's very exciting, and I'm sure that next year there will be somebody from Africa. I actually manage staff in 17 different centers in Africa. It's very exciting. And I think that this is a myth that there is this digital divide, if you will, because in many places such as Bangladesh, such as Nigeria and others, they are way ahead of the English language space. They've skipped generations. And so that is also another wonderful opportunity for us to communicate with them.
Taylor Wan.
To the question of the professor again, the tweets might be in multiple language, but the platform itself was how it's developed, served in the United States, and governed generally by U.S. law. And it's evolving that U.S. law is dominating the behavior of these institutions. And I think on the point of convergence with the U.S. government, there's some interesting intersections there. I mean, one is we as citizens have entered into the bargain with these social platforms that will exchange data for free services, right? So we've willingly given a huge amount of data about ourselves to these companies right at the same time as Western states are building up their surveillance capability. So a natural convergence there. The other convergence that's occurring, though, is that these large technology companies are increasingly moving into, at least in the United States, into federally regulated spaces. They're becoming auto manufacturers. They're building their own cable systems and fiber optics lines, right? These are spaces that require very close collaboration with the government. So I think there's something interesting going on there to watch. On the second point about balkanization, I mean, I would argue there's a whole host of different balkanizations happening simultaneously right now. We're seeing autocratic regimes creating their own internets in Russia, in China, around the world. We're seeing countries pulling out of global internet systems like Brazil in response to Five Eyes surveillance systems and Western government surveillance systems. But we're also seeing certain walled garden technology company driven balkanizations in the third world as well, or in the developing world as well, where you have companies like Facebook moving into large markets like India and giving free access to the internet if you use Facebook as your sole entry point to the internet. This in itself is a form of balkanization of this standard global internet that we tend to think is the norm, but increasingly isn't becoming, I think.
Thank you very much. Let me get two brief comments from our other two panelists, and I'm afraid we will then have to leave it there with the audience questions, because we do still have a special message for you at the end of this session.
I'll just try to wrap it up, because there are different issues raised. I would mention one issue that I think is extremely important, talking about digital diplomacy or any interactions in cyberspace, and this is this fragmentation and a different ways of different governments doing things that are really not in line with international conventions and resolutions that we have. For example, I will just mention one, UN landmark resolution on internet freedom from 2012, I think, said that our rights, so human rights, are the same online and offline. And if we look what the governments are doing around the world, is everything but not what is stated in this resolution. So I think that the governments are extremely vocal and very happy to say, yes, we are for interactions in cyberspace. Yes, we are for free flow of information. But what they are actually doing is not reflecting all those wonderful words on paper. And this is something that we need to do in order to make sure that there is a more political will in order to preserve cyberspace as a space where we can interact in a safe and very direct manner. At the same time, I think it's extremely important to note that any fragmentation, or this I call them electronic curtains, will not serve as a benefit for the society. And no matter how much the governments are trying to make these curtains, I don't think I call it a lost battle in cyberspace. It will just take the societies backwards and not forward. And this is something we all need to engage international organizations, governments, civil society, in order to make sure that internet remains free and safe. And this is not just, you know, for the sake of saying it. We need to take into account all security issues, all problems that we are facing. But I see more movements in restricting than actually opening up, and that is a problem.
Thank you. Jan Melissen.
Just very briefly, on the question that was asked via Twitter, is this a waste of time? I guess it's not, in a way, because the challenge that comes to diplomacy in the digital age is probably the greatest challenge, to my mind, the greatest challenge since the foreign ministries were invented in the 17th century. If diplomats don't go digital, if they don't adapt to the digital age, they would become totally irrelevant. So in that sense, no waste of time. At another level, sometimes it is indeed a waste of time. When I look at the Twitter handles of ambassadors and I see what they're posting, I'm really wondering with what kind of purpose they are on Twitter. And there is time invested in that. And talking to diplomats from many different countries, I hear that there are different, there are layered realities. On the one hand, foreign ministries saying there are nice declarations that they are now online, that they are digital, they are practicing online diplomacy. But you meet the diplomats on the work floor who really don't see that their managers tell them why they should do this. In other words, it's not sufficiently steered by policy objectives. And I think we're in that sort of transitory period right now. That's where I started out, where we're all trying to find our feet, trying to find our voice in diplomacy. But this should be triggered by policy aims. This should be triggered by the aims of your institution. Very briefly, on the gentleman who was detained via Twitter, strictly speaking, not an issue of diplomacy, but of course it raises the very important point of governments that like to, that exercise the social, use the social media to exercise control. And there you see a disjunction there that on the one hand how governments are very successful, some frighteningly successful, or even political parties in election campaigns to use social media. On the other hand, to how they have to live with the reality that indeed lack of control, as Nik Gowing said, is really the rule of thumb for everybody.
Thank you very, very much. And indeed, many thanks to all of our speakers for this very, very interesting, thought-provoking, occasionally also disturbing discussion that we've had on cyber diplomacy. Before we take a break, we have a special message for you from Germany's foreign minister, Frank-Walter Steinmeier. He appeared here live last year and said that a free, open, and secure internet is a central pillar of global governance in the 21st century. He is with us this year once again, but appropriately enough, given the subject we've been discussing, he will appear to us now in podcast. And let us hear his message before we go to a coffee break. But I think probably also Terry will have a few words for you after the message about what's coming next. So please don't rush out of the room, but let's take a look at what Frank-Walter Steinmeier, Germany's foreign minister, has to say.
Sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, verehrte Gäste aus aller Welt. Ich begrüße Sie alle sehr herzlich.
Ladies and gentlemen, honored guests from around the world, I would like to welcome you to Bonn and thank Deutsche Welle for inviting media representatives from all over the world to the banks of the Rhine River once again. I would also like to take this opportunity to congratulate Deutsche Welle on yesterday's launch of its new English language television news program. This is an important step in ensuring Deutsche Welle's place among the world's leading independent international broadcasters. At this year's Global Media Forum, you will discuss the effects that digitization is having on media and foreign policy. You who report on foreign policy are increasingly under pressure to raise your click rates. Not even foreign policy itself is free from this trend. If you want lots of clicks, you need one thing above all: lots of new photos and fast. Social networks make the distance from a mobile phone camera to living rooms all over the world very short. Unlike the avalanche of images from crisis regions, the methods of conducting foreign policy may seem slow and old-fashioned. From the conflict in Ukraine to the Iranian nuclear program, diplomacy takes time and involves long days and nights of tough negotiations to find compromises. And very seldom do these result in fascinating photos. It can take months or even years to reach acceptable agreements. Compared to the waves of dramatic pictures in the internet and on the evening news, it often appears that the international community is incapable of reacting quickly enough. But foreign policy must not be tempted to respond with supposedly quick and simple solutions. We must continue to seek diplomatic initiatives patiently and resolutely, regardless of how much time and effort this takes.
Mit Beharrlichkeit und Geduld müssen wir immer wieder die diplomatische Initiative suchen.
That doesn't mean that social media channels don't also offer diplomats fantastic new opportunities too, such as a means for politicians, citizens, and experts to exchange views. I like to avail of this opportunity myself on a regular basis, for example, on my Facebook page. I read the comments posted there almost daily, not always with pleasure, but I almost always gain something from them.
Lese ich fast täglich und ich gebe zu, nicht immer nur zu meiner Freude.
By the way, the Federal Foreign Office has also used social media for a long time. To date, over 100 German missions abroad across the globe have their own Facebook pages, and more than 50 of our embassies and consulates use news channels such as Twitter. Web 2.0 is thus invaluable as regards expanding the number of diplomatic tools traditionally at our disposal. However, it cannot replace these tools any more than it can replace the need for high-quality journalism, whether online or on paper. With that in mind, I hope you will all have many exciting discussions about media and foreign policy at this year's Global Media Forum.
You might think he had been here, picking up on a lot of the messages we heard from you. Let's keep that applause going for our panelists one more time. Thank you so much. Back to you, Terry.
Thank you so much, Melinda. That was Germany's Foreign Minister, Frank-Walter Steinmeier, there. We're about to take a break now for about half an hour. But before we do, I just want to give you an overview of what's coming up during the rest of the afternoon. We do have a rather action-packed schedule. It consists mainly of workshops, the first one beginning just after our break. But during this break, just now, Taylor Owen is going to have a press conference just upstairs on the second floor, if any of you would like to attend that. The title is How Technology is Redefining International Relations. That's just upstairs on the second floor at the press center, 11:15 to 11:45. At 11:30, the first set of workshops of today will begin. That will lead up to 1 o'clock. At 1 o'clock, we'll have lunch. Lunch will run from 1 to 2, and that's when the second set of workshops or parallel sessions begins. What's important to note about the workshops at 2 o'clock, there is an addition to the program. A new workshop has been introduced. The title of the workshop is Access to Energy in the Digital Age, and it is hosted by Energizing Development. It is in room C. It's not on your written program, but it should be on the monitors in the hall. If you have any questions about that, please do ask at our information desk. So, after the second set of sessions goes till 3:30, at 4 o'clock, we'll have a break, and then at 4 o'clock, our last set of parallel sessions of workshops, they run until 5:30, and at 5:30, a very important event will be happening back here in the plenary hall. That will be the Bob's Awards Ceremony, recognizing outstanding contributions to international freedom of expression, and we invite you all to be back with us for that. That, following the Bob's Awards Ceremony, there will be a reception just next door at Deutsche Welle's Broadcasting Center. All you need to do is just walk across, and we hope it won't be raining. If we're all lucky, we won't need our umbrellas. In any case, do enjoy your break. I wish you a successful and productive afternoon at your workshops, and look forward to seeing you all back here for the Bob's Awards Ceremony at 5:30. Thank you.